Professor Dave and Chegg here. To understand molecules, we need to know how to draw them using line notation. But we also have to be able to look at a molecule in line notation and visualize it as it truly is in three dimensions, since line notation is just a shorthand way of representing molecules. Let's go over some details about the different conformations alkanes can take on.
The first thing we want to understand about organic molecules is that the atoms are not rigidly fixed in place. Sigma covalent bonds occur due to direct orbital overlap, whether via atomic orbitals or hybrid orbitals. So as long as these orbitals are overlapping in this way, the bond is intact. What this means is that rotation can occur freely about this internuclear axis, because no matter how much this spins, the overlap will remain. Zooming out, what this means for an entire molecule is that every single sigma bond is rotating all the time. Ambient thermal energy is converted into molecular motion, which can be vibrational, translational, or rotational. We will get to vibrational motion later when we examine IR spectroscopy, and translational motion is how they move around, either in the air or in solution. But rotational motion is what we will be concerned with here, as rotating the sigma bonds in a molecule will produce different orientations for a molecule which we call conformations. Let's start by looking at a simple molecule of ethane so that we can introduce some basic concepts regarding conformational analysis. Take a look at this molecule of ethane, CH3CH3. We have a sigma bond between the carbons, and as this rotates, the orientation of these hydrogen atoms with respect to the hydrogen atoms on the other carbon will change. In order to analyze these conformations, we have to be able to draw something called a Newman projection. Here we will visualize ourselves as being very tiny, sitting in front of this carbon atom, and looking directly down this carbon-carbon bond. This circle represents the front carbon, and the back carbon, along with the carbon-carbon bond, are obscured from view. We will see these three hydrogens on the front carbon, as well as the bonds to them, which will originate from the center of this circle. So those will go in these directions. Then, although we can't see the back carbon, we can see the hydrogens that project from it. So these bonds will start at the edge of the circle, indicating that the bonds continue behind that front carbon. Those will go in these directions. This is called a staggered conformation. The dihedral angle, or the angle between a CH bond on the front carbon and the next CH bond on the back carbon, is 60 degrees. This is the lowest energy conformation for the molecule, because it puts the hydrogen atoms as far away from each other as possible, just the way that groups oriented around a central atom will spread out as much as possible. This is because they will have a tendency to reach the lowest potential energy possible, given that electron clouds will repel one another, just the way a compressed spring will have a tendency to relax back to its equilibrium position. If we rotate the front carbon, we can allow ethane to move towards another conformation, which we call an eclipsed conformation. This is where the hydrogens on adjacent carbons are directly overlapping. They are closer than they were in the staggered conformation because there is only this distance separating them, as opposed to the additional lateral distance when they were staggered, which required finding the hypotenuse of this triangle, and the hypotenuse is always the longest side of a right triangle. Because the hydrogens are forced to be a bit closer together, this is a higher energy conformation. We can see this energy diagram here that explicitly shows the discrepancy in potential energy as this sigma bond spins and we move between staggered and eclipsed conformations. Now let's make things a little more complicated. Let's turn this into a molecule of butane by replacing one hydrogen on each of these carbons with a methyl group. So we are looking down the C2-C3 bond of butane. Now we have more than just two conformations, because these groups are not all the same. These methyl groups yield more steric hindrance than hydrogens do. This term refers to the repulsion between groups, whether on the same molecule or two different molecules, and it becomes more significant as these groups get larger. For this reason, with butane, it will still be the case that staggered conformations are lower in energy than eclipsed conformations. But the lowest energy conformation of all will be this anti-conformation, whereby the two methyl groups are 180 degrees apart. The highest energy conformation will be this eclipsed conformation, where the methyls are right on top of each other. In between, we have these other two eclipsed conformations, and then we also have what are called gauche conformations, which are staggered but involve alkyl substituents at a 60-degree dihedral angle. We can see the relative energies of these conformations on this energy diagram, and we can see that these methyl groups make for a large discrepancy between them. So, with this rudimentary introduction into conformational analysis, we now have a much better understanding of how line notation is not just convenient, but also supremely accurate. When we draw alkanes in this zigzag fashion, we are drawing them in their lowest energy conformation. These are all staggered conformations about every carbon-carbon bond, and all the carbons are anti to one another. The ability to draw Newman projections will be very helpful at certain times as we learn about various chemical reactions.
If you are having trouble visualizing molecules, generating Newman projections, and discerning these wedge and dash bonds as being to your left or right, depending on which direction you are approaching the molecule, make sure to practice as much as possible using a molecular model kit if that's helpful to you. Professor Dave for Chegg. See you next time.